So when he raises up one from among your brethren, he will speak wisdom that you have never heard before. And he would confound the wise with what comes out of his mouth, fulfilling what is written in the scriptures. I will take the foolish things of the world and confound the wise with them. And he who is this without letters learned? Farrakhan didn't get no degree from the Sorbonne. Farrakhan didn't get no degree from Oxford or York. Farrakhan didn't get a degree from Yale or Princeton or Harvard. The world cannot claim Farrakhan. So what you see come out of his mouth comes from on high. What you see him do is being guided and directed by a God who is present in the world, working out the salvation of a suffering people. I, God, do not change. And in the fullness of time, the man that you meet in him and his life will bear witness to the life of Abraham and Ishmael. His life and what he does will bear witness to Moses and Aaron. His life will bear witness to Jesus and Muhammad. Here he is, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. All praises due to Allah for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. That means God is the greatest. We thank Allah for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Go ahead, Brother Minister.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we give him praise and thanks for his intervention in our affairs in the person of Master W. Farad Muhammad, the great Mahdi, who came among us and found one worthy upon whom to place a weighty word and a weighty mission. That mission is referred to in the scriptures of the Bible and Quran as the resurrection of a dead nation of people. I thank Allah for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. I thank Allah for blessing me to be with you, especially the laborers of the nation, for 3 days. This is supposed to be a special day. They call it Mother's Day. They only do this to make money off of our love for our mothers. There is no special day for mothers. Every day is Mother's Day. The female is exceedingly important in the scheme of the divine. She is so important that when the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was asked, after Allah and His Messenger, who should we honor next? He said, your mother. The companion said, who then? The Prophet said, your mother. The companion said, well, who after that? He said, your mother. The companion, somewhat exhausted, said, and who after that? And he said, your father. For the Prophet to say three times, next to God and the servant that admits us into the mercy, favor, guidance, and beneficence of God, that mother is next. That should tell us the value of the female in the sight of God and how valuable she should be in our sight. For nothing is more important than the preservation of a species. As I read once, God is not interested in individuals, only in the preservation of a species. So since God is interested in the preservation of a species, and the species is preserved and extended through the female, then how the female is looked upon in any society is how God judges that society. Since the female is so important in the scheme or plan of God for the deliverance of humanity from its condition, then a whole surah or chapter of the Quran is named after the most important woman to ever have been born on this earth, and that woman is called Maryam or Mary. Mary is so important that the angels literally had a dispute among themselves over who would have charge over Mary, because Mary was the owner of the womb that would bring forth the Messiah. This messianic figure that would come from the womb of Mary would signal the presence of God among men to redeem humanity and reconnect humanity to God after our disconnection through the disobedience of Adam. We can't even get to redemption except through a woman that gave birth to a redeemer. Some of my Muslim family may take issue with my saying that the Messiah represents the presence of God in a human being. But I challenge any scholar anywhere on the earth to deny the truth of the Holy Quran. The Messiah, according to the Quran, would be taught. Listen to the words. Taught the wisdom, the book Al-Kitab, the gospel, the Torah. That's enough to let you know that the Messiah is the most important human being, because God would teach him, listen, not reveal the book. The book had already been revealed, but the book needed to be taught, meaning the wisdom of the book would give that possessor of that wisdom the power to do what the book is designed to do. Listen. The book is designed to heal the wounds that Satan had inflicted on the whole of humanity. The book is titled Al-Nur, the light, to guide the people that have walked in darkness, and that is the whole human family of our planet. The book is a manifestation of God's power to possess the human being.
I'm going to say it again.
Once you are taught the meaning of the word of God and you eat that word, like the Son of Man was told in Ezekiel, eat this scroll. Eat it. It'll be sweet in your mouth, but bitter in your stomach, but eat it anyway, because when you eat the word of God and it becomes a part of your being, then your eyes become God's eyes. Your hearing becomes God's hearing. Your tongue becomes God's mouth. And your hands become God's hands. And your feet become God's feet, because now God has taken possession of your very being, and you become a God yourself. This is how we know that you have not been taught the book. You only have heard the revelation of the book and some tafsir or some explanation, but nobody knows its interpretation but Allah, and He will reveal that to a servant of His in the last days of this world to bring about the opening of the eyes of the blind, the opening of the ears of the deaf, the unloosening of the knot in the tongue of the dumb, and the raising of the dead to life by Allah's permission.
That is not man's work. That is Allah's work. For one of Allah's attributes is, He is the giver of life. He is the raiser of the dead. So when a human being starts giving life and raising the dead to life, then you know that God is present in a man. He's in the world. His will not be frustrated. He has come to take over the rule. The government of America will be set down. The government of China will be set down. The government of Russia will be set down. The rulers of the United Kingdom and the European Union will be set down, because it's time now that God should take over. God has a problem with the rulers of the world. They are, as Jesus made a parable of them, He called them the wicked husbandmen who had charge over the vineyard. And every now and then, God would send someone into the vineyard to check the fruit. And the scripture says some they beat, some they imprisoned. But the heir, H-E-I-R, the heir to the vineyard, he slew. So Jesus asked, what will the owner of the vineyard do when he comes? And the answer was given, he shall utterly slay them. Some people right now in high government positions are on death row, but they don't know it. May think that these little fleas have power. But it is written of the Mahdi, he's a human being. Born of a woman. But according to the hadith, the sayings of the Prophet, that he would set justice in the earth, and that he, a man, would set down every tyrant. He would kill the swine and break the cross. Dear Christians, don't be upset. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, an emblem of suffering and shame. But that one that will come will end the suffering and relieve you of the burden of your sin that makes you ashamed. For your sins are to be forgiven and thrown in the sea of forgetfulness if you would believe on Him. So, This one comes by means of a woman. Then the woman is very important to God. But there's another force in the world called Shaitan, Satan, or devil. Well, the woman is also important to Satan. Because if Satan can corrupt what God is going to use, by whom and through whom he brings the Messiah, he must try to taint every womb and corrupt every heart of every woman in order to defeat the will of God. The Holy Quran says, of course, he failed because Mary and the purity of that woman, she was such a wonderful woman. From the beginning, her mother, when she knew she was pregnant, she vowed what was in her womb to God. That's telling you how you should begin when you know that life is now in your womb. Start right then. Get on your prayer rug. Get on your knees and vow what is in your womb to the service of God. A vow is an oath or a pledge that the whole being of the person is involved in making that vow or that word bond. When a woman is like that, she starts that new life off in the right manner. Mary was careful of the food she ate. In fact, the Quran says that when Zacharias would bring her food, she had already eaten. Something to be understood. I'm feeling kind of good today. I didn't think I was going to make it this morning. They kept asking me, how you coming out? I said, I don't know. Depends on how I feel. I've been working pretty hard, but here I am. All praise to God. A good woman should be in the charge of a good man. God had seen fit that Mary would be in the charge of a righteous man. My dear sisters, it's difficult for you to be what God wants you to be unless there is in your life a righteous man. God saw fit that all the conditions were right for Mary's mother. And when Mary was born,
It was a female. And the Holy Quran says, and the female is not like the male. Well, why would God waste time saying something that is so patently evident? She is not like us. Oh, female. You are the representative of God's mercy, His beneficence, and His unequaled love. That's what gets you up in the night when your baby cries while we sleep. That's what makes you feel danger for your child. That's what makes you love unconditionally. Your child may be sick, your child may be ugly. So ugly sometimes that somebody looking in the crib may offer it a banana. I just wanted to say something to lighten the spirit. No mother's child is that ugly. At least to the mother. John Wayne Gacy's mother could say he was a good boy. Dahmer's mother, boy, eating people's livers. But he was such a sweet child. Ain't that mothers, it's not that mothers are stupid, you know? But they just love. You're very special. And that's why there is no day that passes that should not honor you. Every morning that you wake up and your mother is alive on this earth, call and tell. Thank you, Mom. Don't judge her. God didn't raise any of you to be the judge of your parents. No matter how weak they may be or how off you may think they are, the Quran says, remember that they cared for you when you were young. You could not care for yourself. God does not like you to raise your voice to your mother, to your father. But the best of men, Prophet Muhammad said, is he that is kindest to his mother and his wife. Any man that beats a woman, any man that dogs a woman,
Any man that cusses his mother, any man that raises his voice and worse his hand to a mother, in this life, God will pay you back, because the law that Allah sent down with Moses, honor your mother and your father, that your days may be long in the land which the Lord your God gives you. The enemies of God who commercialize on everything. Humanity cannot continue without birth. So they're there at birth to collect. The breast of the female is made for the baby. But the world teaches you against the proper use of your breast. And their chemists get in a laboratory and make up something that could never equal. Even a sick mother's milk is better than Enfamil or whatever that other thing is. Similac. But they commercialize on the need of your baby. My God. You can't die. They're right there. To bury you, it takes money. If you've amassed anything in life, please make a will. Do something that will keep the government. A death tax. God has to end a world that's as low down and rotten as a world like this. And I'm with God to end this world. Now, since Adam's fall, recorded in both the Bible and Quran, that the devil or the serpent wanted the woman, in the Genesis, the serpent didn't come directly to Adam. He tried to get at Adam, but get at him through the woman. That shows you how important she is to take you up. And if Satan gets to her, she's an instrument to take you down. Look at the words in the Bible. The Lord God called to Adam, said to Adam, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." And God said, "Who told you that you were naked?" Now look at God. Look at how wise he is. He teaches every prosecuting attorney how to interrogate a witness. He already knows the truth, but he's setting his man up. told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat? Well, you got it. Then instead of the man saying, "Yes, Lord, I disobeyed," check him out. He said, "The woman." He was a real punk, wasn't he? Hey, you're not a real man if you can't take the heat of your own action. You gotta find somebody to blame. So here come Adam. "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the tree and I ate." You still didn't answer the question. I didn't give the command to the woman. I gave direct orders to you not to eat of this tree. Why would you let the woman that I gave you offer you something and you not tell her, "Wait a minute, baby. Hold up, sugar. Evidently, you desired to eat it anyway. Now you're going to use the woman as a cover for your rebellious spirit. But you can't fool God. Look at how he answered it." And God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" Check her out. And the woman said, "The serpent deceived me and I ate." Oh. Now check this out. Now when you read the creation story, you read God created all these things, so forth and so on and so on. He created the man, then gave the man a woman. Ain't heard nothing about the serpent until after God starts giving Adam orders. Then a snake comes to the woman. Now look at what God said to the serpent. "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. Then the gender changes. He," now the woman becomes a he. And God ain't dealing with nothing funny here. "He shall bruise your head," the serpent, "and you, serpent, shall bruise his heel." It's from the King James Version. Now, the Quran doesn't say it like that. It doesn't use serpent as such. It comes out just a little clearer. It said the devil made them slip, caused them to forget. The devil. So there's something
synonymous with snake and devil. And you always find the snake trying to deceive you. Because if the snake can deceive you as a female and make you eat what is forbidden, then you will corrupt everything that comes from your womb. And the devil will be the winner. And so from Adam, Eve, and the snake came two children. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, this thing starts in Genesis as a snake. But this fight goes on in the Revelation. The snake has become a dragon. Now, my father, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, was taught the Torah, the gospel, the book, and given wisdom and guidance. I'd like to explain what he said this means. Did you know that every prophet or messenger of God in allegorical or metaphorical language is styled as a woman? Because as the female bears patiently the foolishness of her children, a prophet or messenger of God bears patiently the ignorance of his people as he attempts to reform them and make them better. This is why the pronoun changes here. And he shall bruise your head. So now you're talking about a woman. It's in the future now, but it's really a man. A man empowered by God to redeem and bring a people to birth. And the serpent now is after the woman and her child, because the child that the woman is carrying is a man child who is destined to rule the nations with a rod of iron. So the serpent, now the dragon, must destroy the woman and her child. But in Genesis, God said, he'll bruise your head. Well, that's the end of the serpent. Once you get the serpent's head, it's over. But the two of them will be at war with each other. And the serpent will bruise his heel. And as your heel follows you, the heel, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad says, represents that the devil is going to hurt some of the followers. But the woman is going to get the head. Now let's bring it on down to 2002. Moses was drawn out of water as a champion of freedom for his people. But the scripture says, and I will raise them, a future people. I will raise them up a prophet, Deuteronomy 18 and 18. I will raise them up a prophet like unto you, Moses. But I'm going to put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. So you get Quran and Muhammad, you get the gospel and Jesus. Muhammad spoke what God commanded him, and Jesus said, whatsoever the Father tells me that I do, whatever he bids me to speak, that I say. So both Jesus and Muhammad the prophet, whether you want to agree or not, are a sign of one whom God would reveal the meaning of the book to. In the last days of the world. And that one would come out from among a people that the world knows are dead. A people resembling the children of Israel. That as the children of Israel were in bondage under Pharaoh 400 years, this people would be in bondage to a powerful ruler for 400 years. That hasn't happened to no people since the children of Israel, but the black man and the black woman of North America. For 400 years, we have suffered the evil of America and her citizens that hated us without a cause. In Atlanta, Georgia today, there is a showing of the pictures of the horror of our lynching. Billie Holiday said, strange fruit. Unless you are black, you may empathize with us, but you will never know what it means to have been black in racist white America unless you are black like us. Now, those of you who are Palestinians, you're beginning to learn a little. Those of you who are Arabs, you're beginning to learn a little, a very little. And some of the people that saw those pictures could not complete going through such an exhibit. It broke them down and they walked out. Some of the whites said it was horrible.
that such should have been done. Others said it shouldn't be shown because it opens up old wounds. Then close down the Holocaust Museum. Close down the museum that chronicles the suffering of the Jewish people. If it's wrong for us to see what was done to us, then it's wrong for anybody to see what was done to them. How else can reparation be a justified cry unless the world knows what was done to us? Present-day whites don't have to feel guilty. You didn't do this. But you must feel responsibility to make wrong right or suffer the judgment of God. And now, in Revelation, the 12th chapter, now a great sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then, being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his heads. His tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and his throne. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. A woman clothed in the sun, with the moon under her feet, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that this is a sign of this holy woman who in the last days would give birth to the Mahdi. She's a woman clothed with the sun, meaning she's wrapped in the light, in the power of God's love. Look at this now. She has the moon under her feet. Moon here represents the prophets. As the prophets like the moon, have no light of their own, but the prophets reflect the light of God in his absence, as the moon reflects the light of the sun in the darkness of the night. So all the prophets said that such a child would be born. Isaiah the prophet said, "For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and a government shall be upon his shoulders, and he shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government of peace, there shall be no end." What a woman to bring forth such a child. Satan upset, because Satan knows, if I don't destroy this child who is destined to replace my raggedy rule, but he will rule the nations with a rod of iron, the unbreakable, unbending, unyielding law of God. And all who live under his rule will be in obedience to God's will. And therefore, as the Quran says, in the hereafter, everywhere you go, you'll just say, "Here, peace, peace, peace." The salutation will be peace. But hereafter, hereafter, an adverb of place and an adverb of time. Here, here where? On this earth. After what? After the power of the wicked is broken on the earth, God's kingdom will rule, and peace and brotherhood shall be the theme of the whole human family, and it will look as though it were a new earth, because there'll be no more weeping, no more crying, no more insane asylum, no need for hospitals, no disease. A new world. Now, where does President Bush fit in all of this? Where does the present Arab-Israeli conflict fit in all of this? Where does President Bush's bloodlust for Saddam Hussein fit in all of this? Did the elder Bush, when he was vice president under Ronald Reagan, say that the minister was a bad man? And when he became president,
did I make my announcement of his plans against the rise of young blacks in this country? And when he was asked about my announcement, the government said, no comment. Dan Quayle was President Bush's vice president. This past week, they tell me he was talking about the good of the Million Family and Million Man March and the principles that undergirded them. But he said, Farrakhan is a dangerous man. What is it that makes me dangerous? Well, let's wrap it up. And war broke out in heaven. And Michael and his angels fought with the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail. Nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame the dragon by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives to the death. There is about to be a great war. This war has already started. It is a war first of truth and falsehood. The battle is in the sky. Meaning that those on an earthly plane don't yet know the struggle that is going on the highest levels. As Paul said, we war not
with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in high places. The Catholic Church is shook now. The church is troubled now. Because some of the high-ranking cardinals have shielded those who have destroyed the lives of little boys. You cannot imagine what happens to a little boy or a little girl when sick men and women work to destroy the innocence of children. Sometimes they never in life overcome because they trusted a man that they call father. They trust a person that they call their minister. They trust a person to whom they can reveal the innermost secrets of their personal lives, thinking that you, as a man or woman of God, will not take advantage of them. Even in prison, murderers and robbers are hard on those who misuse babies. So when they get to prison, their behinds are in deep trouble. You're not gonna hide behind no cloak that you were a priest. Once you get in there, they're gonna deal with you. And you are worthy of death because you have killed a little child and their innocence, that they may never recover from what you have done. The church should not be slow in having a zero tolerance policy for that kind of behavior. I say that to the nation of Islam. We will not tolerate not only any abuse of children, but I want to sound the death knell to those who would make merchandise of the sisters. That's a no-no. Zero tolerance. That's the end of your ministry. Any minister that would do this is like a dentist that would put a patient under and then take advantage of that patient or a lawyer who would deceive your client. You that are the professionals, be careful. Your day is coming. In fact, your day is here.
Now, there's a war brewing there that the Bible says when Jerusalem is surrounded by armies, flee. This is the final war coming up, where holy places are no longer respected. The birthplace, they say, of Jesus. A war zone. Sharon himself started this latest round of violence when he went up on the property of the Dome of the Rock with 1,000 or more soldiers. He believes that that is a part of the Temple of Solomon, and that as a Jewish person, those grounds belong to them. So he could defile what Muslims feel is sacred to them. And some Muslims don't care what is sacred to Jews. This is very bad behavior. Allah says to us in the Quran that we should respect every house where God's name is remembered, whether it is a church, a cloister, a synagogue, a mosque, a temple. You don't defile those places, nor are we permitted to fight in them. That's a pitiful situation there. Sharon is a man with his mind made up, and the Palestinians are also, through their suffering, they have a mind that they will never stop. There will be waves and waves of suicide bombers that President Bush wants the Muslim world to condemn as suicide murderers. But the people in that part of the world, in that culture, see them as martyrs. How do you see them, Farrakhan? I grieve over their loss of life, and I grieve over the loss of the lives of Israeli women and children. Although we knew that this kind of thing would take place, you cannot deprive another people of their humanity without their losing respect for yours. Yes, And that is what has happened in the Middle East. The humanity of the Palestinians has been devalued. So they are devaluing the lives of Israeli men, women, and children. You say it's against the law of God to commit suicide. That is true. That is true. We, as Muslims, are forbidden to take our own lives, no matter how desperate the situation appears. God gives it. And that's a sign of our faithlessness. That the condition that is so terrible to us, that we have lost faith that God can help us to change that reality. And so we would rather be dead than to face the consequence of our sins or the consequence of our ill health or whatever. Suicide is forbidden. Jesus did not commit suicide. But he offered his life. He told his disciples before it happened what would happen. And when he went to his trial, Isaiah the prophet said he was as a sheep dumb before its shearers. He opened not up his mouth. He knew that after their saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, on the day that Christians call Palm Sunday, in just a short while after, they would be saying, crucify him. I'm about to wrap this up. Osama bin Laden did not want American soldiers in the Holy Land. He was angry with King Fahd and the royal family for permitting American soldiers on that land. Now, Jews and Christians and Muslims have lived in that area for thousands of years. They have their problems, but they've lived side by side. When America sent her soldiers there, I went to the Arabian Embassy in Washington, D.C., and talked with Prince Bandar. And I said to him, brother, it is a mistake for you to allow the American soldiers in the Holy Land. I said, for 6,000 years, they have wanted to get a place back in that land. I'm going to tell it all now. Thank you.
I said, once you get them in, it'll be very difficult for you to get them out. America and the United Nations planted Israel there for a reason. It has nothing to do with the messianic promise to the Jewish people. And this is why for 50 or more years, they have never had any peace. And unfortunately, it is very doubtful whether there will be any peace in that area unless justice comes to the Palestinian people. There is no desire in Ariel Sharon to trade land for peace as it was with Yitzhak Rabin. Since he has been prime minister, 34 new settlements have gone up on the West Bank. He is using Bush's war on terrorism to say that the legitimate struggle of oppressed people under a wicked apartheid system do not have the right to defend themselves or their land from the warmongers. Who are using American tanks, F-15s, F-16s, helicopter gunships, to retaliate against the desperation and despair of men and women and children who would strap bombs on themselves to show Israel and the world, we can no longer tolerate living under these conditions. The world should take notice. President Bush has come to the table late. And what is his motive? Oh, I know his motive. Has nothing to do with a better life for Palestinians. His motive is to appear, to give the Palestinians what they want in some independent Palestinian territory so he could line the Arab nations up with him in his attack on Saddam Hussein and the people in Iraq. He has that in his mind, and he's making these deceitful concessions. What does this have to do with Mother's Day? You know, mothers, because America has offered no jobs to the less learned or the poor, and factories that were in the inner cities are moving out, then drugs and guns
are purposely moved in to feed a prison industrial complex with young black and brown lives. Your children that didn't want to sell drugs or be a part of gang warfare have joined the armed forces. They get a steady paycheck and they appear to be doing something wonderful for their country. President Bush is like the Roman Caesar, who, when he sees trouble on the horizon, he gives more shekels or more dinars to the soldiers. President Bush is like the Roman Caesar, who, when he sees trouble on the horizon, he gives more shekels or more dinars to the soldiers. But if he goes to war in that part of the world, many young Americans will die for what? What can Saddam Hussein do to the United States of America? They have a no-fly zone to the north and a no-fly zone to the south. And America has been bombing them, and England has been bombing them for the last 10 years. And they have not been able to shoot down one American or British plane. How could they be a threat to the United States? Regardless of what you think of Saddam Hussein, it is not America's right to go into Iraq to sit that man down. That is the right of the Iraqi people. And if they don't do it, then America is in violation of international law, interfering with the sovereignty of another nation. But they don't care because that's a weaker nation. But in truth, Israel already has every weapon of mass destruction. Everyone. And Israel right now can destroy the whole Arab world. And if Saddam Hussein gets weapons of mass destruction, he will balance the power that is in Israel. And Israel does not want one Arab nation to have a weapon to challenge the weapons that America and others have helped her to gain. You can take it or let it alone. Now, and war broke out in heaven. Not in the sky. Hell no. Ain't no war in the planets. War broke out on the heavenly part of our planet that is now being turned into hell, and Michael and his angels will fight the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail. That means that they will be kicked out. In our lessons, we are asked the question, why did we take Jerusalem from the devils, and how long ago? This
is not talking about Salahuddin, but a war is going to be fought there, and blood will be shed there. That area will be purified for the true sons of light. It's almost wrapped up now. You're right at the end. I'd like to close. When the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. But the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and times and a half a time from the presence of the serpent. So the serpent spewed water out of his mouth like a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away by the flood. But the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon had spewed out. And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now let's get it on. There is no free ride to heaven. Some of us are going to die. But those of us who love our lives more than we love God's will and the establishment of God's kingdom, you've already lost your life. But those who are willing to lose their life for God's sake will find eternal life. Now I'm going to say some things in the closing moments of my lecture that I want you to keep in your remembrance, because President Bush, if he goes the way he plans, he will end America as the power that America was and is. Listen carefully. Any Arab or Muslim government that lines up with President Bush will be chastised by Allah, and it will be the end of their power and their authority to rule. I'm warning all of the Muslim world. You either going to be Muslims, or Allah will kill every last one of you and bring a new people in your place. If you side with evil, you go down with evil. The American people have to be warned. President Bush is a blind leader. And if the blind lead the blind, all are going into the ditch. I close this lecture with my experience 17 years ago. Where from a tiny village in Mexico, in a vision-like experience, I was taken to the top of a mountain in a little village called Tepoztlan. And there, one of the little UFOs came by the side of that mountain. I was accompanied by people and I was somewhat afraid, and I tried to get them to come with me. And from the wheel, a voice spoke, not them, just you. I was told to relax, and on a beam of light, I was taken up into this wheel. This wheel is spoken of in the book of Ezekiel. Go read it. The Son of Man that was set down in a valley that was full of bones. The Son of Man that was told, prophesy unto the bones. A Son of Man that was told to warn the preachers, woe to the shepherds. A Son of Man, and I am that Son of Man. The Son of Man was told, eat the scroll. I come before you, I need no notes. The notes are already in my belly. The word is sweet in my mouth, but it caused me suffering and pain. But the word must be told. The scripture says, I send you to a hard-hearted, stiff-necked, and rebellious people. Their head is hard, but I have made yours like a flint. I am a stone, all right, but a stone of stumbling. If you fall on me, you'll be broken into pieces. But if I fall on you, you will be ground into powder by the power of the God that has backed me and sent me to mission you and raise you up. When I was taken to that great wheel, that is a half a mile by a half a mile, the Bible tells you that everywhere the Son of Man went, the wheel went with him. And I can tell you the wheel has followed me everywhere I go. I am empowered. I am backed by a power bigger than the power of George W. Bush. You can take it or let it alone. This is the end of this world. When I was on that wheel, I heard the voice of Elijah Muhammad, my teacher, whose voice I heard for 20 long years. He spoke to me. He didn't allow me to see his face, but he told me that Reagan had met, he said the president has met with his joint chiefs of staff to plan a war. I want you to hold a press conference and make known his plans and tell them that you got it from me, Elijah Muhammad on the wheel. That man is not dead. He is alive. He is the Jesus that you've been looking for, that escaped death and is now at the right hand of God with power in his hand to destroy this world. You can take it or leave it, but I'm not holding a damn thing back, because after I say what I say to you today, and when you see me do what I'm about to do, then you'll see God do what I tell you God is going to do. Listen, I'm not trying to excite you, but for a long time, I have held my peace. I have never spoken to you about who I think I am or who I know I am. It ain't about thinking no more. I want you to know that I'm born to defeat this enemy with the help and the power of Almighty God Allah. We'll get him back for all the hell that he has poured on the black man and woman of America. Now listen. This man has to go to war within the next year in order to fulfill what he has openly said, that it is the policy of his administration to remove Saddam Hussein from power. As it was in the beginning of my experience, it was Reagan meeting with the Joint Chiefs of Staff to plan a war against Libya, a small Muslim leader, a small Muslim nation that was a thorn in Reagan's side. He tried to kill Muammar Gaddafi, but he missed. But I was to learn that as the war was against a Muslim nation over there, it also was against a little brother in America that was over a small nation of Muslims, but a thorn in the side of the government of the United States of America. It's now come full circle. Little Bush is going to try to fulfill
what Big Bush didn't do. And he intends to use the lives of the black and the brown and the poor white to fulfill a vendetta that has nothing to do with democracy or a threat to the United States of America, her power, and her well-being. But since he has promised now to find Osama bin Laden and Mullah Muhammad Omar and bring them to justice, and he hasn't found them yet, and he has promised that he will destroy or unseat Saddam Hussein, then he must fulfill this during his first term of office, or he does not feel he'll get a second term. So within the next year, he has to move. I hope if I frightened you all, it's all right. Listen, man. Let me tell you, you can become afraid if you want to, but every word you hear me say, you're gonna face it. So you can run, but I'll be damned if any of you will be able to hide from the wrath of God that is coming down on America. Give me 10 more minutes. It was Gaddafi in the beginning. It is Bush now in the end. It's been 17 years since that experience. And he intends. With Reagan, it was a secret. They met and discussed getting rid of Muammar Gaddafi. It was the most expensive assassination attempt in the history of the world. And he failed. He will fail again. Now, he will go to war, even if he has to go alone. I warned him that the coalition was not going to stay together. Let me tell you something. This is my home. This is the country of my birth. I don't hate this country. I just hate the way the world has treated the people, particularly black people. I wish that I could make President Bush see the error of his thinking. But unfortunately, just like Moses spoke to Pharaoh, but God hardened Pharaoh's heart because he raised him up and made Egypt great, that he could destroy Pharaoh and Egypt, that the world may know him as God. I represent that God. That is about to wipe America from the face of the earth. America is more wicked than the wicked in the days of Noah. She is more in error in homosexuality and lesbianism than Sodom and Gomorrah. She is more wicked as a slave master than Pharaoh was to the children of Israel, as she is to you and me and the weak and the poor of this nation. She has the potential to be the basis for the kingdom of God. There are good people in America. There are people in America that if they knew the truth, they would act responsibly. There are people in America that want to see the filth and decadence of this country turned around. Yes. There are people in this country that want to close these sex parlors and these places of filth and indecency. There are people in America that if somebody would just talk to them. But the media does not want any voice that will challenge that which is coming from the administration. So whenever I speak, they drown it out. That's why I'm a dangerous man. I'm a dangerous man not because I have weapons. I'm a dangerous man because I have truth. I'm a dangerous man because I'm not afraid for my life to tell the truth. That's what makes me dangerous. So they'll go to war over there. But I, if I oppose this war, which I will do, like Brother Martin Luther King, he felt compelled to speak out against Lyndon Baines Johnson's prosecution of a war in Vietnam. And many of his friends, in quotes, when Martin King said that the government was wrong, his friends backed away. And even preachers turned against him. They would not allow him to preach in their churches. The FBI went crazy to stop Martin Luther King. And a year after he had declared from the church at Riverside Church in New York that his conscience made him to stand against such a war, our brother was assassinated. My conscience is searing. It's burning to see what our government has done in Afghanistan and to see what she plans to do, all for oil and drugs and gold and guns. So I'm like a voice crying in the wilderness. But I believe that if I stand, though I'm not looking for none to stand with me, because God is sufficient, but I believe that I will not stand alone. I believe the righteous in America are going to rise up to stop an unjust war that will kill many innocent Americans and many innocent Iraqis, Arabs, Palestinians, and Jews as well. Blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called the children of God. I'm finished. It's something about a man who makes this kind of commitment. That's when he knows who is around him. It's easy to follow a man in the cool of the evening. But it takes some kind of man to follow you in the heat. of the day.
Beloved brothers and sisters, if it is the will of God, and I go overseas, if it is the will of God, I tell you, our effort will be to try to stop a war. But I know that to do that will cause the dragon to be enraged. The woman is not a physical woman. It's a man that is pregnant with a nation that is now time to be delivered. The woman is a man of God that will bruise the head of the serpent, but the serpent will bruise his heel, meaning that the followers, some of them will be hurt by what I'm about to do. And the dragon will curl his tail and take down a third part of the stars of heaven, which means that he's so wickedly deceitful that he will deceive the scholars of religion, Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Buddhism. He will try to wrap the scholars around him, and he will cast them to the earth. And if he can't do what he went over there to do, the dragon is going to come back to earth, meaning America, and he's going to be angry at the woman. Well, before I go, I'm going to Washington. I'm not asking nobody to go with me. No. Listen. I'm going to talk to this man for the last time. I'm going to tell him what he's going to face. And if he thinks that he can destroy the place that gave birth to Abraham, that was once the seat of the Khilafah, I will say to the President of the United States that the God that I represent, who has power over wind and rain, hail, snow, and earthquakes, if you think you have a bomb to destroy Baghdad, I will bound you that I will call on my God to show America that he can destroy not one of your cities, but every city that you got with just one great earthquake. Oh, many lives will be lost. But you got to know that you've been playing with God too damn long, and your days of playing with God is all over. God is tired of America. And God can end America like Jehovah ended Egypt and Pharaoh. Bush gotta know this. Now, Farrakhan, y'all getting scared? Oh, I was gonna ask you, what are you scared about? I'm doing the talking. You can all run and hide, but there ain't no hiding place for me. I'm calling for a showdown with the wicked of this world and all the Baal prophets. If your God be God, then let him stop what I'm about to do. See, Farrakhan went off. Hey, the boy went crazy. Boy actually believed that God is with him. I'm gonna show you. You gonna believe too when you see.
Now, when I talked to the president, not that I'm going to the White House, but I think I should give him the message. And then I'm going over. He got this one. Oh, yeah.
His agency, and I hope you got it down. But I'll give you a tape. I'll give you a tape. You can send it to him right away. But in closing, he probably won't listen because he's drunk with his own sense of power.
But it's a dangerous mission, Reverend Allen. They may try to kill me while I'm overseas. But he whom Allah protects, they can't destroy. But I want us to know that that's in their mind right now. But I want to tell them what's in God's mind, so when they make their move on me, watch what my God does with them. Now, look at this. Thank you. Thank you. My brother, quoting the scripture, no weapon formed against the righteous will prosper. We are winning today. All we got to do is hold on to faith and clean up our actions, so that we are the moral superior of what God is displeased with. Now,
if it pleases Allah, only Allah can stop me from going. If he stops me, I ain't going, naturally. But if he permits me to go, I'm gonna visit these countries that are said to be the axis of evil. Libya. I'm going, inshallah, to Mecca to make Umrah in my condition. Inshallah, I'd like to go to Riyadh and meet with the Crown Prince. I will go to Yemen, to Oman, to the United Arab Emirates, to Syria, to Jordan, to Iran, to Iraq. If it pleases Allah, I would like to go into Israel. There are Jewish rabbis that said that they want me to come. I would like to talk to Mr. Sharon.
I know he's a soldier who has a set mind. But you never know what a man of God can do if you talk to a rock. Moses was able to touch a rock with his rod and brought water out of stone. I hope if this modern Pharaoh's heart is stony, that I might, with God's help, make him see that it's not worth the lives of the American soldiers to fulfill a vendetta. I hope I can make Ariel Sharon see that the Palestinians deserve what you have fought all the days of your mature life for, a sovereign state that is free and secure. The Palestinians deserve this. Well, I want to go to the Sudan. I want to visit President Mugabe in Zimbabwe and South Africa, Thabo Mbeki, and then come home. Before I go, I want to help our people, the American people, to see that my aim is to stop a war. How can you stop it? By encouraging the Muslim world to unite and not take part in that which will bring upon them the chastisement of Allah. Because it's Saddam Hussein today, it's Muammar Gaddafi the next day, it's the Crown Prince the day after, it's Bashar in Syria the day after. Once he can get away with unseating somebody that he does not like, then where does it stop? Where does it end? This makes America a criminal nation. And that's why this president has backed out of a treaty that he signed. He does not want to be a part of that which will try American generals and American president as a war criminal. So when I go, the hat was already dropped with Dan Quayle. He's dangerous. See, Jesus was dangerous. You see? Now where I'm headed is to the cross. I just want to tell you straight up. The cross does not mean a literal cross. But I'm headed for that is written. That they charged him with sedition. And those that say they loved him turned, just like they turned on Dr. King, see? Farrakhan wrong. But he going over there meddling with that stuff. We over here, we had these needs, you understand? And now Bush done froze all our bank accounts. Bush done did this, now he's persecuting the Muslim. Well, it said that he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. He said, now, he may want to bring me into court. I ain't saying nothing. I'm an innocent man. I haven't done a damn thing but good. It ain't my trial.
your tribe. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Yeah. A bunch of people are always there. But the people that should have been there, they were running and hiding.
Six women and one disciple showed up at the cross. I hope y'all won't punk out like that. I don't have nothing to defend. I'm not against my government. I'm against the stupidity of her leadership. I'm against a policy of war and destruction. I'm against the misuse of black, brown, and poor white soldiers. I'm against the lies and the deceit that is fostered on the American people to make them go along with this madness. So that I'm forcing their hand now. Then if God be God, and he is, then whatever the bitter cup is, I'll take my drink. It's something to be betrayed by your friends who feel a level of comfort will be taken from them unless they side with the enemy. It's something to have people sitting around your table eating your food and then rise up against you. But you're going to see all of that. They may lock me down like they locked Paul down and like they locked Jesus down, but something happened, you know? See, if you're really dealing with a dead man, you don't need a stone at the tomb. And then the stone was rolled away. And when they looked, the man they thought they had, the woman was given the wings of an eagle, and he flew away to be nurtured for a time and a half time. But don't worry. See, none of you saw Jesus when he left. But some of you will see me when I go. And some of you will watch as he goes through the clouds. And the man that you see go, you'll see him coming back in like manner. But those that pierced him, they're gonna wail and weep when he returns, because America won't be the same America no more. A new government will be here. Watch and see. I'm through now. I put it on your mind. Now you go search the pages of scripture that you say you believe in. And if I don't compare with what you've been reading, then I'm a liar and a false man. There ain't no sense in me hiding from you no more. I either am or I am not. And you will soon know that I am. Thank you for listening, and may Allah bless you as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.